This is a reading from the Lessons on the Epistle of St. Paul to the Romans by Maria Valtorta. July 16th, 1950, to the Romans, chapter 9, verses 25 to 29. Does it not occur like this also amongst men? When a father, a good father of the family who has loved his children with a just love, has worked for them and has worn himself thin in order to give them well-being, who has watched over them in order to make them grow healthy in body and in spirit, sees himself disowned by them, abandoned, or mistreated, or exploited, or more, does he not perhaps turn his need to love and to benefit on some other poor, orphaned child or illegitimate child, the most agonizing of all the orphanhoods? And does he not perhaps receive him by adopting him and by destining to him those goods which the children of his own blood have rejected? All this in order to love and to have one who will love him. God the Father does this, and he has done this. He had loved man from the beginning of humanity. Amongst men, he had particularly loved the ancient just ones, the fathers and the patriarchs, full of dignity, prudence, worth, justice, and every other kind of virtue. And consequently, they were pleasing to God, from Enosh to Noah, from Abraham to Isaac and Jacob, and later to the great Moses, leader and savior of the chosen people, legislator through the will of God, who entrusted the law and the orders to him, to Aaron, the first high priest, to Joshua, who brought to an end the orders given by God to Moses regarding the possession of the promised land for the children of the chosen people, to the judges and prophets and kings. How much love had God given to his people through these chosen amongst the chosen? However, for having felt themselves infinitely loved, they fell into the same sin as Adam. They believed everything to be lawful. They believed it was useless to obey God. Not only, they dared to criticize the actions of God, and they judged them either useless, or foolish, or satanic, or as impossible. The more God, from heaven, the Father, and on earth, the Son, manifested the nature of those prodigies, of those words, and testified with the very same prodigies, and with the wisdom of those words, that they were of God, the more Israel judged the prodigies as satanic, that it was Satan who performed them, and blasphemous his words, and sacrilegious his actions. And God repeated the gesture he performed towards the two prevaricators of Eden. He repudiated Israel, and in order to have a people, he elected the Gentiles. It has been prophesied by the Spirit of God to Hosea, his prophet, "Your mother, the synagogue, is no longer my wife. I will not have pity on her children, because they are children of harlotry. I will cause all her mirth to cease, her feasts, her new moons, her Sabbaths, and all her appointed feasts. And I will say to those who were not my people, the Gentiles, 'You are my people,' and they shall say to me, 'You are my God.' And still, prophesying to the few who, of the already numerous people of God, of the people of He who is, of ancient time, and of the ancient temple, who would have become the new people of God, Jesus, and of the new temple, it is said, 'The remnants, I say, of Jacob,' that is, the just Israelites, like those of the direct lineage, and of the primogenials of Jacob, shall be converted to the mighty God." And it is said that which Paul says, by quoting other points of the prophecies of Hosea and Isaiah, and that which was said accomplished. That which was said was accomplished. The Gentiles became his people, together with the few Israelites who knew how to receive the Christ, thus becoming the children of God. Children are much more than subjects, because subjects are not permitted to live in the royal household, whereas this is granted to children. And the children of God, brothers of Christ, will live in the house of the King of Kings forever. July 24th, 1950. To the Romans, chapter 9, verse 30 to 33. If the coming of the kingdom of God, kingdom of love, justice, and purity, were only to have been for the Israelites and the Hebrews of the diaspora, it would not have brightly shone, since, being Jesus, the man-God, universal King and of infinite power, all of humanity could have aspired, merited, and obtained the kingdom of God within itself first, and the kingdom of God in God later. If this call and inheritance to the kingdom had perhaps remained circumscribed only for the Hebrew people, something that would have only been able to occur through a striking miracle of God, capable of shattering an erroneous world of ideas that, stubbornly, the Hebrews defended from anything that was able to make them fall and be dispersed, how could one have possibly said that God is an infinitely good Father to all creatures, endowed with a spiritual soul? The others, all the others, scattered throughout the then known continents and those still unknown, how could they have been able to say at the end of time that God was good and paternal to all men? They were not guilty of having been born in other countries and in other religions. If there was a fault, it was one of the Hebrews. It was the one of the Hebrews who had a bitter hatred and a fastidious disgust for anyone who was uncircumcised, even if he was, to a greater extent, more morally just than them. Never, for this unjustified disgust, and contrary to the command of love towards one's neighbor, which is not only formed of compatriots and fellow believers, never had Israel tried to make the true God known to those who worshipped many gods, and not even to those who, for being particularly virtuous amongst the pagans, for so much did they feel their being a true God, different from the false gods, one, holy, a creator in a very different manner than what the mythical legends would say, the guardian and motive of all of creation, that they raised an altar to the unknown God, keeping it there for centuries, almost invoking him, and without a precise command from the incarnate word, go evangelize to all the nations by baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching to them what I have taught you. Not even the best of Palestine, the elect, those taught by him for 3 years through word and example, would have been able to remove the heavy stones of their Hebrew conceptions, and who judged as an abomination and an impurity everything that was not of Israel, combining in contempt the Samaritans with the Phoenicians, with the Romans, and with as many who were not of the synagogue of Israel. The Acts of the Apostles testify to this persistent obtuseness and aversion even amongst the apostles, even amongst the same apostles. Jesus, the Master, who for 3 years had explained to them that his kingship was not of this world, who had refused their every insinuation to make himself king, who had reproached their dreams of human glory as far as making one of them his traitor for the disappointment of a vanished delirium, is about to return to the Father, and while blessing them again as he is about to leave, after having already once received the Holy Spirit from him, John chapter 20, verses 22, in order to be able to understand the supernatural and spiritual things, in order to be able in this way to absolve by understanding the mysteries of the heart and of the flesh, again they ask him, will you now rebuild the kingdom of Israel? Acts chapter 1, verse 6. They still had not yet understood, since they were the ancient Israel, that the Messiah was the king of a spiritual and eternal kingdom. And years later, when Saul was already Paul and Peter was the pontiff, and full of the Holy Spirit for quite some time, the prejudice towards the Gentiles was still so alive that God had to work a twofold miracle. Acts chapter 10, verses 11 to 16, and chapter 10, verses 25 to 33, in order to persuade Peter not to refuse the centurion Cornelius of Caesarea, and a confirmation be it for Peter, as for the other apostles and brothers of Judea, who were ready to reproach Peter for his conduct. Acts chapter 10, verses 44 to 48, and chapter 11, verse 2, and verses 15 to 17. These things, certain because they are contained in a final part of the gospel, which the fathers of the church considered acceptable and of faith, are proof of just how strong the prejudice against the Gentiles was, even in the best of old Israel and in the saints of the new church of Christ. However, Jesus, the Redeemer of all those with a just will and spirit, calling to the kingdom all men, wanted to give evidence and proof that all men are predestined to heaven so far as it depends on God, being He, the loving and provident Father of all men. The Gentiles did not seek justice, the true justice, not out of scorn for it, but rather because they did not know that it existed, nor did anyone teach them that it did. However, having known that it did, they embraced it, and with a heroism of faith which amazed the world and made it Christian. Truly, the mud of paganism was cleansed by the rivers of blood of the martyrs who, for the most part, were Gentiles converted to Christ, and the smoke of the stakes on which the heroes of Christ burned purified the world, while the foundation of the church had been given by the bones of the confessors, cemented by their ashes and blood, and their own names testified how many people the Gentiles gave of martyred confessors of Christ, and how Jesus, by calling to the kingdom all men, testifies that the kingdom was predestined to all men, so that it could be given to those who would have merited it with their virtues. So the Gentiles, by choosing with a spontaneous goodwill of wanting to be part of this kingdom of God, in man first, in heaven later, testify that every man can belong to it, provided that he wants to, irrespective of his past. Israel, on the contrary, though having known justice and wisdom for centuries, and had it wanted to, would have been in the position to complete, perfect, and receive the living wisdom and the living justice. Jesus, divine and incarnate wisdom and justice, did not want to seek this completion, this perfection. Rather, instead of receiving, he who came in order to make them truly just and wise, rejected, oppressed, and killed the holy and wise Christ and his followers by persisting in its evil will. Israel did not want to be just, never, neither towards the Master, nor towards the Thaumaturge, nor towards the Messiah, nor towards the Incarnate Word, nor towards the Innocent One. It condemned the words and actions of the Master and Thaumaturge as blasphemous and satanic. It derided and called the Messiah a liar and sacrilegious. It did not want to acknowledge the Word whose divinity was evident, even to one who did not want to admit it. And he who deserved every honor as both the just man and as the true God was given the cross instead. This is always what perpetual Israel does, that is, the immortal class of Pharisees and scribes towards the just, towards the servants of God, the elect of God, the enemy of everything that is holy and good, an enemy of God and an enemy of the servants of God. It agitates its poisons, the inheritance of Adam's sin, against men, and it makes them concupiscent, that is, envious, spiteful, false, and unjust towards the saints who serve God in the way in which God has called them to serve him. Israel, the ancient and the new, has the word of justice, but it does not have the spirit of justice. It did not have it 20 centuries or so ago, and it does not have it now. The word, rather an avalanche of words, the unbearable burdens placed on the shoulders of the little ones, whereas on their mighty ones they do not place any, the doors shut so that it be impossible for the peoples to enter into the kingdom of heaven, the tithes that are paid for a visible respect to the law and which don't weigh heavily on the rich, whereas they are a burden to the poor, for whom there is no justice and charity, that is, the most essential things of the law, and in order to justify their harshness, egoism, and avarice, the money which would have been better spent to relieve a poverty is defined as korban. All these things which Christ spoke of to his friends and enemies with the very impartiality of he who is truthful and detached from every human thought were and are the word and not the spirit of the law, and are an impediment to entering into justice. And so Israel did not enter into justice, and by remaining bound and mummified in the formulas that it had given itself, buried and made blind by the heap of stones which it had weighed upon its intellect and upon its spirit, it remained devoid, like a cadaver, of life, of the perfect faith, that of Christ and in Christ, that which would have been light, the cornerstone, and also and above all for it, became the stumbling stone. Of that stone which Isaiah had spoken and predicted, and which also Christ prophesied by the old Simeon as the ruin and resurrection of many, and the sign of contradiction, says, the stone which they rejected has become the cornerstone, and whoever shall go against this stone will be shattered, and those who will be struck by this stone, the falling of the same upon them, will be crushed. Who are those who are shattered by going against the stone? Jesus' church. The enemies of Christ, who is the stone, church, head of the same. It has not yet been seen that a true great opposer has been victorious over the Roman Catholic and Apostolic Church. 20 centuries of history shows that whoever raised their arrogant hand upon the church and went against it out of hatred had its perverse dreams of glory shattered, as the ecclesiastical condemnations show. They are not a word, but a reality which God underwrites with his will, and that those struck by them, condemnations, can only experience ruin in time and in eternity. Who are those upon whom the stone falls, crushing them? Those who invoked that crushing stone upon themselves by crying out, "His blood fall upon us and upon our children." And that blood fell, and it crushed the temple and the altar, the priests, the mighty ones, and even the least of Israel. And with them it crushed their foolish national pride, their merciless harshness towards the least ones, and their erroneous deductions and convictions regarding the kingdom and the Messiah King. It crushed everything for centuries. Nor has the crushing ended, for as long as from the pride and from the stubborn blindness of Israel, the same, even if the stone fallen on Israel has pulverized and scattered the pride of Israel like dust, the humble invoking cry of forgiveness does not rise, the cry of knowledge and of acknowledgement that the Eternal One awaits for 20 centuries so as to forgive Israel of its horrendous sin of deicide, and in order to readmit it to the saving vision of Christ. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to Christ, Son of God, through an eternal generation, and to the Son of David through a human generation of the Virgin. Shoot from the root of Jesse, the flower, the inviolate lily, which has come from this root, through whom, having appeared the Spirit of the Lord upon the virginal and immaculate corolla, came the Emmanuel. Until that moment, the condemnation will weigh heavily upon Israel, whereas for those who, notwithstanding where they are from, believe in Christ, or at least through goodwill, for having practiced justice and through charity exercised towards one's neighbor and towards the perceived God, even if he is not known, belong to the soul of the church, there will be affirmation of their hopes and a reward for their virtues.